guys for having us. Lakeland was actually my very first college that I ever attended in the United States. So I'm kind of excited to be back here. I'm always like a huge proponent of community colleges because I think everybody should start there. But a couple of years ago, when I became a SANE nurse, I kind of quickly realized that there's a huge gap in the healthcare system when it comes to identification of human trafficking victims. And last year, I met Kristin, who is from the Office of Opioid Safety Office, and we quickly realized that our population heavily, heavily overlaps, and we kind of became the traveling duo.
Very much so. As she said, my name is Kristin Hess. I'm from the Office of Opioid Safety. I don't think my mic is on. Now we got it. Okay. I'm from the Office of Opioid Safety. I'm the Clinical Education Specialist. I, too, am a Lakeland graduate. I actually went to EMT school while I was still in high school many, many, many moons ago. And then I also went to nursing school, too. So I'm still currently a paramedic in the state of Ohio, and I've always worked in areas that were affected by the opioid crisis, but it didn't really become personal to me until I realized that one of the girls that I graduated with from Perry High School out in Lake County was a human trafficking victim in Cleveland. And I realized that it doesn't discriminate just like opioids don't discriminate. And when Anna and I started working together, we realized there was a huge gap in awareness on how opioids are used by human traffickers. And we really have a very big bias in healthcare against people who use substances. And so oftentimes, trafficking victims aren't recognized because all we see, and these are not my words, these are my friend's words, are a junkie. She was in the healthcare population many times, and people just simply regarded her as a junkie, even though all of the red flags were there, and she was sitting there with her human trafficker, and nobody saw her. So that's why we do what we do, and we've had a lot of success, and Anna can share more of those specific things.
So for those of you that aren't aware what forensic nursing is, it is a specialized field of nursing, and we merge the medical care with the legal aspect of patient care. So what does that mean? It means that I work with victims of crime, trauma, violence, abuse, which includes sexual assault, and it also includes human trafficking. We play a very critical role when we bridge that gap between the law and the medicine. And we make sure that all of our victims receive both the medical attention that they so desperately need, but also the justice that they so desperately deserve. We collect evidence, we provide medical treatment, and of course, my favorite part is to testify in court, because at times I am the only one that is able to give the victim a voice, because sometimes they feel like they don't have a voice or they're afraid to speak against their attacker, which is where we come in. And so my favorite quote that I learned a couple months ago when I heard another presenter say is, the eyes are, what the eyes can't see is when the mind is blind. And I quickly realized that I was in the very same situation when I was a baby nurse back in 2016, 17. And I had a victim, and we all saw her as a silly 19-year-old girl who partied a little too hard, overdosed, and her life ended as a result of an overdose. Little did I know that a few years later, when I would be sitting in a SANE class learning about human trafficking, only to realize that the red flags, she had every single one of them and down that check mark. And my heart sank to the floor when I realized that we completely missed a beautiful 19-year-old girl who we could have possibly saved. And so it became my mission when I took over the coordinator's position at MetroHealth that I would educate the entire department. But then I realized, why stop there? Why stop just at Metro? Why not educate the community, the people that live in the neighborhoods where these young girls are being trafficked out of? Because the more we know, the more we are aware of, the more we're seeing, the more victims we will be able to identify.
And that goes across the board for opioids as well. because it doesn't matter what field we work in. My husband works for Dominion Energy, and he's heard me come home talking about these things to where he literally called me a couple days ago and goes, Chris, I'm sitting down in Cleveland, and I think I see a human trafficking victim. And I gave him the number for the 4th District Police because he's working on the streets of Cleveland, and he would have never recognized it. It's simply that, you know, whatever lane we're in, we need to talk about the opioids and human trafficking because it doesn't discriminate, and it's everywhere. And so taking it back to our communities and talking about it is how we can make a change in both of these areas.
So whose responsibility is it? Everyone. Healthcare, sheriff's department, corrections. We have been educating correction officers. Mm-hmm. Last year, the last three groups that we educated, every single one of the groups actually identified a trafficking victim while they were being booked.
Let me give you some groundwork on that. So I worked at the Cuyahoga County Correctional Center as a nurse during COVID. I worked in many different roles, including a Metro Lifelight nurse, and that was one of my most challenging roles. And I realized when I left and I joined the Office of Opioid Safety that there was a lot of knowledge that was not given to me when I entered that arena, and also the COs didn't know it. So I went back and I started talking about how do we recognize an overdose? How do we manage an overdose? How do we manage withdrawal? How do we recognize withdrawal? And when I met Anna, she came to me, she's like, I have been dying to get to the jail. And I'm like, well, I just happen to know some people, because I was already going back to the jail and educating them on everything that I learned. So then we started doing the traveling show there where I would talk about the opioids, and then we together would talk about the opioids and human trafficking. And so it's all of the cadet COs that had never had this training before that their eyes are open because their mind is no longer blind and they're seeing these women. And it, let me tell you, it's gratifying. Every time she calls me, he's like, Chris, they got another one. And I'm like, yes. Because we're going to show you these women are there, and they had never been trained. And we're trying very hard to get into the Lake County Jail, too, to make sure our officers there are being trained, because this is just as important in every single county.
But it's not just about identifying them. It's also about providing and advocating for them for their future. So while they're in county and they're under arrest, her unit helps with the substance use disorder. My unit helps with the therapy sessions. Like, we have contacts that we set them up. We start therapy. We have trauma recovery team that helps with food and shelter when it's time for them to go. So we make sure that they have a safe place to go. It's not just about to say, oh, look, we got one. We got another one. We make sure that we follow up on that. We recently met two young ladies from recovery.
The recovery court dockets at Cuyahoga County through Judge Sinnenberg. Yeah.
And so once we know that there's somebody being booked, we notify them, and then they take a look at their docket and say, okay, is this something that, you know, was this like a drug debt that was related to her being done while she was being a trafficking victim? Can that be something that can be, you know, taken away so that she has a clean slate? Obviously, I'm no lawyer, so I don't know how that all works, but I do know that I have somebody who advocates for these young women and men, but majority of what we're seeing is women that we've been identifying, but men do exist too. So, you know, why learn about human trafficking? Because it can happen to anyone. And some people are more vulnerable than others. And a lot of people fail to spot. And interesting enough, there was a study done in UK, and 24% of people responded that they had no idea what human trafficking was. They couldn't even define it. And 34% thought that human trafficking was related strictly to immigration. And if anybody's here old enough, do you remember back in the day we used to have this joke about mail order brides? That's what they thought it was related to, you know, getting these young women to bring them here to the United States to marry them, but then abuse them. This is what they thought human trafficking was, right? But we know it's more than that. 20% only thought that it only related to prostitution, that it couldn't be anything else. So this is something that I learned in my progress when I was learning more about human trafficking. It happens in our correctional facilities too. Women are being trafficked while they're incarcerated, or they're being recruited while they're being incarcerated. And in healthcare, up to 88% of victims have access to healthcare. They come in for routine healthcare checkups, sexually transmitted infection, treatment, and testing. They come in to have their babies. They come in for medical appointments, and we're missing them. I know at Metro, prior to me doing our education, we found out there was two women in our system that delivered their babies, and we never actually identified them. And it wasn't until after I did my education that we identified them and we were able to help them. So this is a quote from one of the survivors. You know, she said that she came in many times on the streets and she went to private clinics and nobody ever asked her about anything.
The first time I met my trafficker, I was 17, and I was introduced to dancing in a strip club. And then that's kind of the way I kind of entered the dark world of trafficking, which I was in for about 7 years off and on. And I tried to leave, as you know, a lot of people, that's the main question is like, why did you stay? Why didn't you leave? And I tried to leave several times. One in particular, I left one time, and then he actually said, hey, if you don't come back, I'm going to kill your mom and your daughter. At least every couple of months, I would try to go seek medical treatment. I went there to, you know, see if I can, you know, just check to see if I had any STDs, to see if I can get condoms, and also to make sure that I took birth control. But when I went there, no one ever really asked me, like, what's going on and how come you come in so often? You know, they're not asking, why do you want to take, you know, STD tests, you know, so often? I think there were signs that, and questions that they could have asked, but they didn't.
It's important for registration staff to be educated on signs and symptoms because they may see dynamics happening between the patient and the companions in the waiting room that the physicians and the nurses wouldn't see.
You have such a short amount of time. So just these different opportunities that you have, it's like we have to act on them. Every clinic needs this training, because victims are across this country going in to seek medical treatment. Thinking back to my exploitation, had the staff been trained back then, my life may have turned out a lot differently. It's a dark world. It's so dark that you have to fight daily to see the light, like even after you leave. Like you have to fight daily to make sure you hold on to hope, because it can seem like so hopeless. There's no way out for these kids and these victims. But then I think of myself and I'm like, there is hope. There is hope. Yeah.
And that's what I hear every single patient tell me. They didn't see me. They didn't recognize me. All they saw was just another junkie, or all they saw was just another prostitute. And it breaks my heart. And my goal, my hope, that one day we don't ever hear people say that, that a woman can walk into a hospital and we recognize that they need help. So that brings me to human trafficking. In the state of Ohio, nurses, we are mandated to report gunshots, stab wounds, burn injuries, now strangulation, domestic violence, especially if children were involved. But interestingly enough, we are not mandated to report adult human trafficking suspicion. Morally, should we do it? Absolutely. But there's no law that actually mandates us to report an adult victim. We actually have to have their permission before I call a detective. Obviously, 18 and under is automatic call, like DCFS and, you know, the detectives and the human trafficking task force. But it's really sad that there's no law that mandates us to report it.
You know what's crazy too is in Ohio we're not mandated as nurses to have human trafficking education to renew our nursing license. We have to have it in the world of fire and EMS, we have to have it as a beautician, but it is not a mandation in the state of Ohio for nurses. And I think that's really wrong because there's nothing more powerful than a nurse who's got drive and conviction. And if all of our nurses' eyes were open and we were taught this from the beginning and we were taught it and reminded every couple of years, could you imagine how many people we could help and identify? We could change the world. And I really think that needs to be revisited.
Approximately 98% of victims in Ohio are between the ages of 21 to 29. And I have seen some in their early 30s, but the majority of the victims that I've met, that I've taken care of, were in between that age category. And I've seen some, obviously, some younger ones. Last year, there was 310 cases that were identified, and 86% of them were females. That means there was a small percentage of males, but it's a very small percentage. It doesn't mean that they don't exist. They're just a lot harder to identify. And a lot of it has to do with stigma. And according to the FBI, it is the third largest criminal activity. Anybody want to take a guess why? When we think about drugs, right? You have one pill. How many times can you sell that pill?
Once.
How many times can you sell a human being? We recently had a victim. She had a daily quota of $1,000 quota daily. The pimp made over $40,000 on her in 1 month.
And he had, like, what, 7 to 12 girls?
Mm-hmm.
And that was it means that she had to service 7 to 11 Johns a night, and she was not allowed to wash in between.
We are number 5 in the nation for human trafficking. See the big red blob in the middle? That's us. Anybody want to take a guess why? Yeah, freeways.
It's the same thing with drugs. Okay, our drugs are coming across the southern border and they are coming into America and they're traveling up through Ohio. That is why our statistics, we'll go over it later, are so similar, is because they're both traveling along our highways and we have a lot of major highways in Ohio.
Anybody want to take a guess of how to define human trafficking? It's okay if you don't, that's why we're here. So human trafficking, it is the recruitment, harboring, transportation, provision, or obtaining of a person for either sex, labor, or organ harvesting. And it's done through three forces: force, fraud, and coercion. Now, when we think about force, fraud, and coercion, we think the movies. Big bad guy, he coerces you, he twists you, he pulls you in. But what if I told you I had a 16-year-old victim a couple years ago who was not coerced, but she was frauded into human trafficking by her friend, who was her classmate. She wasn't a big bad guy, she was a 15-year-old friend. And my victim happened to be in foster care, and she confided in her friend how bad her home was and how badly she wanted to get out of there because she didn't like the foster home that she was in. One day her friend came to her and said, "Hey, my uncle said that if you wanted to come over and hang out with us, you know, for the weekend, you could totally do that, but we just have to be quiet." And of course, she's all excited. She was 14 at that time. And so she didn't tell anyone, packs up a couple of her things, runs away from foster care. When she arrived at her friend's house, she told me that once the door closed, there were already 3 men waiting for her to service. And then over a period of a year and a half, they branded her and they've transported her what we assume were state lines. She couldn't exactly tell us, but she would tell us that they would put her in a van and they would drive around for a long time and then bring her to the hotel where they would have parties. Of course, substance use was involved. And I have no idea how she got away. She wouldn't disclose to us, but the reason I'm telling you this is because I don't want you to think that force, fraud, and coercion happens with big bad guys. It can happen from somebody you know. It can be a family or a friend or a boyfriend, right? A pimp can be anyone.
So when we talk about how are opioids tied in this, we've been talking heavily about human trafficking. We're fifth in the nation for human trafficking, but we're also fifth in the nation for opioid overdose deaths. We lose on average anywhere from 5,000 to 5,500 Ohioans every year. We actually lose about 7,000 Ohioans to alcohol every year, okay? So, but opioids are way up there. And it's the same thing. I want you to understand that human trafficking is very much so in Lake County. It is here, it has been here, and it does affect our children. And opioids are directly tied to how they are recruited and also how they're kept into the human trafficking situation. So there's really important conversations about both things that we need to have with our kids. So, like I said, I grew up in Lake County, and I've always worked in Cuyahoga County. Those are our drug overdose rates for that bundle of years. And Lake County is a smidge higher than Cuyahoga County, even though our population is much less, and we're much densely populated, and we're a much smaller area. And so again, it's across the board that this happens in both places. While her and I were at a Lake County commissioner's, we were up in their chambers doing a presentation, we were approached by a couple survivors from Lake County. So they're here. And one of them kept looking at me like, kind of giving me this look, and it was here because she graduated a year behind me. So not only was there one, and for sure in my graduating class, there was one behind me as well. So we already kind of talked about the how drugs are coming into our country. Our southern border is a major problem. This is nothing politically motivated. I am politically neutral, but I literally was on a meeting just a couple of hours ago. I'm on a monthly meeting that gives us the updates of what's going on in our country. And a lot of children that are coming into our country that are undocumented have been lost, and they are involved in human trafficking now. It is a massive, massive problem. That is also how our substances are coming into our country. They are coming through a legal port of entry, though. Okay? And fentanyl is the biggest killer in our community. It is extremely potent, and it is extremely habit-forming. So when Anna and I started this journey in just like January of last year, we sat down, started meeting and educating each other on each other's wheelhouses. We're like, let's build some education together, both kind of pouring into it. We pulled up this statistic, which is not what we're finding at MetroHealth. So we didn't tell you, but in like 2022, we had zero referrals from MetroHealth staff saying, you and I are working together and going, something's not right here. This might be human trafficking. Let's get a hold of Anna. Nobody could have connect those dots together, right? So we started educating in April. We closed out the end of the year with 31 referrals. 21 ended up being documented human trafficking cases. So far this year, since just the beginning of January 1st, we're already up to 10 documented cases identified. That's massive. That shows you the power of education. However, most of those women, where almost every single one of them had active opioid use disorder. One of the survivors that presents with us, her exact words were, I never met a sober prostitute. And why is that? Because opioids allow us to not think and to not feel. And that, if you are having a quota of $1,000 a day and servicing 7 to 11 people, you need to not think and to not feel, okay? So in Cleveland, the Cleveland area, 44109, which is where MetroHealth sits, is one of the biggest epicenters for the opioid epidemic and the overdose deaths. And that is why I make sure that our nurses understand that and that we need to understand how to take care of our population and what resources we have. And it is still a work in progress. Combating stigma in healthcare is one of the biggest things that we can do so that we can treat a person who has substance use disorder with compassion and so that we can look beyond that and see possibly the human trafficking. So when you talk about risk factors for human trafficking, it closely parallels human substance use disorder. And it is one of the things. So you can have an unstable housing or family dysfunction. Sometimes you may see the involvement in child welfare system. You may see it in runaway homeless youth. This is not a total 100%. We have had kids recruited from loving homes in a really great environment that have gotten recruited into human trafficking. Mental health, substance use. We're going to talk about how people who are in treatment get actively recruited out of treatment facilities and correctional facilities. Poor self-esteem. If your child has a need, the human trafficker will fill it. If your kids are putting themselves out on social media and these girls are not, they're showing that they have a weakness, they are going to pounce on that. And that is absolutely what happens. This slide is kind of hard to see, but any type of lack of social support, poverty, but not always, okay? Learning disability or developmental delay, Anna has had a few cases that people with severe disabilities have been human trafficked. And so your radar needs to be on all the time. Involvement or targeted by gangs. My friend was targeted by the Heartless Felons Gang, which if you are not familiar, is a very organized crime gang that stretches from Youngstown into Cleveland and even farther. It is a very large organized crime gang. Family members, parents sell their children when substance use disorder is involved. Their brains become so hijacked by addiction and their use disorder that they will sell access to their children, and we will talk about that more later. So, undocumented immigration status. So, I want you to understand that the knowledge of the dissociative powers, what does that mean? That means that traffickers know how it makes you not think and not feel. And it helps to make people more compliant so that when you start recruiting a child, if you start giving them things, it will allow them to be more compliant to be raped multiple times. So,
so how do they groom? It happens in four stages. They target their victim, they form a friendship or some kind of a bond. There's a loving relationship, right? I'm your best friend or I'm your boyfriend. I love you. I'll take care of you. And later it turns into the abusive relationship stage. And how do they recruit? Well, they advertise on these following websites: Yelp, Craigslist. I actually, one of my victims last year was advertised on Skip the Games, and she told me that. She's like, my boyfriend advertises me on Skip the Games. But they also recruit, and this is where we come in healthcare, correctional centers, dual diagnosis unit, domestic violence shelters, social media, dating apps, group homes, detention centers. So you sit there and you ask yourself, how in the heck are they doing it from a dual diagnosis unit? Well, they get themselves admitted as patients. And during their group sessions, they pay attention. Who has what story? Do they have family on the outside that is supportive? Or are they on their own, fending for themselves? Because that's the person they're going to befriend. Hey, when we get out of here, we should totally support each other. We can just be each other's support. And when they come out, you know, you don't have a place to stay? I do, you can come with me, right? And when they go with them, guess what happens? They get recruited. And the same thing happens with domestic violence shelters. A lot of the times, the women that are currently under a pimp, they get forced or coerced to go to these shelters, pretend to be battered women, and make friends there and recruit from there. Recently, there was a pimp that was taken off the streets, but the victim that was rescued a few days beforehand, we were taking care of her, and by the time the officers got to the pimp, he already had a new victim. And guess where he found her? The homeless shelter. Because that is a perfect victim at the homeless shelter.
So one thing I just want to remind you too is that the girls that are doing the recruiting, they're doing that out of a survival technique, okay? Because there's threats being made, there's things being held over their head, and sometimes some of the things that you'll see also, like in the dual diagnosis unit, sometimes these girls have a legitimate mental health need to go in there. My friend told me many times, she's like, Kristin, I knew exactly what to say to get myself pink slipped and get put into a mental health ward because I needed to feel safe and I needed to be off the streets for a while. And so it may start because there was a real need, but then they have a moment of weakness. Maybe they're withdrawing, and maybe all those cravings are coming in. They reach out to their trafficker, and then they start making threats and saying, you need to recruit somebody while you're in there, or this is going to happen. And so that, I want you to realize, just because these women are also, you know, doing the recruiting, it's not that they're such a bad person. It's because they feel like they have no other option. So this is Carolyn. She's wonderful. We love her to death. She lost her daughter, Courtney. She actually was recruited out of a Lake County dual diagnosis type of facility. I think she was, from what I understand, like in the next like sober living phase or something along those lines. And she met her trafficker there. She was then human trafficked for a couple of years all over the U.S. And she unfortunately was located in January of, I think, 2022 in Cuyahoga County, but unfortunately she was deceased of an opioid overdose. And so I want you to understand, I mean, look at that beautiful face. This could be anybody in your family. So when drug and human traffickers, they use technology. I came across this slide from the National Center of Sexual Exploitation. And if you have kids who have a cell phone and has any contact with social media, I want you to take close attention to this because all of those are updated every year. So that's the 2023 list. I don't know if 2024 has been released. It gives you a breakdown of how each one of those apps are being used by human traffickers to actively recruit not only our teens, but our little kids. Go ahead, Anna.
So there was an 11-year-old girl that was recruited on Spotify. Spotify is a music platform. It has no chatting system. So how did they do it? The guy hacked into her account and changed the name of her playlist to introduce himself. He then gave her instructions on how to change it because she didn't know how to do it. And then within a few days, they became friends and she gave him her email address. And he gave her specific instructions on what to do, how to take pictures, and how to upload pictures onto Spotify so he can look at them. And that's how he recruited an 11-year-old girl or groomed her.
You need to know what your kids are doing, especially if they have technology. This is another reason why. So this is from the DEA drug emoji code. If you've never heard of it, you can literally purchase drugs just by simply putting drug emoji or emojis out there. So those all mean different things. If I'm looking for a Percocet, if I'm looking for an Adderall, because a lot of kids are on ADHD medications, right? And so if I don't need an ADHD medication, but yet I take one, it is a stimulant. It is more performance enhancing. It is very common among teens to take other teens' ADHD medications, Adderall being the biggest one. Well, our drug dealers have found out, they're like, okay, these kids want Adderall. I'm gonna take that market and I'm gonna make them some Adderall. And they buy a pill press and they make what looks like an Adderall, but guess what's in it? Press cocaine and fentanyl. That's how we've lost a lot of college students because they try it for the first time. They're not used to using an opioid and it kills them first time they try it. So the drug emoji code, what happens is you go on something like social media, Facebook Messenger, Snapchat, and I just look for a sequence of emojis or I put what I'm looking for. Okay, so I'm advertising that I'm either looking to sell or to buy. And then I go ahead and connect and I use my Venmo, my Zelle, anything like that. And then guess what? Your kids can have it delivered to your house through things like Uber Eats and things like that. So there's been cases, like I just watched a case the other day that about broke my heart. It was a 12-year-old little girl that their parents did this beautiful tribute on TikTok to, and it was because one of her friends gave her a pill to try, and it was probably bought in that way. Parents had no clue. Again, I'm not trying to get preachy to you, but if your kids have a phone, you need to know what they're doing. So when we talk about how opioids are used by human traffickers, it is the most powerful weapon that they have, above and beyond the stigma that we have against people with substance use disorder. Because when we don't care about somebody, we don't look to help them, and we're not seeing the human trafficking. So when they coerce people, you know, they use substances to induce compliance. So if they recruit your kid on Roblox or Fortnite or Minecraft, all those videos that they're actively recruiting on public chat rooms, and they actually get your kid, what they're gonna do is start introducing opioids because it makes them more compliant. So you also, you know, they have to feed a habit. So if they're looking for someone in a dual diagnosis unit, they're gonna say, hey, remember how she said there's that friendship phase? Let's use together. I'll give you some drugs. Oh, but wait a minute, those weren't free. So now you have a drug debt to me and you're gonna have to work off that drug debt. That's one of the biggest things that we see. So again, that let's use together, the coercion, how they're gonna manipulate them. Narcan, we're gonna talk about Narcan because has anyone here ever seen someone get reversed from Narcan who's had a chronic opioid problem? It's not pretty. It is absolutely not pretty. And if you use opioids every single day and you are dependent on them, when you get a dose of Narcan, it is excruciatingly painful. That is a tool that is used against traffickers, because if I'm supplying you opioids every day and you didn't make your quota or you did something that I didn't like, I'm going to give you a hit of Narcan and then I'm not going to give you anything for 24 hours so you can sit there and think about what you did. So they'll withhold your drugs, they'll withhold your pay, and so you better do what I say or you better behave. They also exploit. They prolong your trafficking. You know, there's just so much that they do. They threaten to report your drug use to the authorities. Why? Because a lot of people who use substances and are being human trafficked are very afraid of the authorities for rightful purposes. The stigma, like I said, in healthcare and law enforcement is one of the biggest things that's keeping us from actually identifying this population.
There were times where I was tied with both hands to the bedpost like this. And both legs, I'm naked. And he would inject me with either heroin or he would put a crack pipe to my mouth and light it for me. I was only 19 and I was just no longer a human being. I was property. He did something that he didn't like. He'd lock you in a room where he'd sell you for dirt cheap. He would let you know that four people just ran through you for $20. He would let you know that four men just ran a train on you for $20. He'd let you know. And he'd let you sit there and think about that. Wouldn't even get you high. Because now you want to get high just to be numb. Just to not feel, to not think.
Every time I hear that, I think of my friends and the time that she had. Like, she has shared very personal things with me that I'm not going to share today. But I could understand not wanting to think and not feel. If I was out there on those streets, I would not want to think and to feel. Two things about that video. Anyone guess who her trafficker was, who she was describing? You'll never guess in a million years. It was actually the treatment facility that she was sent to. This happened back in 2015. That's why there was a reference to heroin. What we very rarely see heroin in our drug population anymore. It's almost all fentanyl. Heroin is there, but it's usually mixed with something else, and fentanyl is the biggest opioid that we're seeing. Fentanyl is much more potent than heroin, okay? It's much, much more deadly. She was actually sent to a treatment facility, and the people, because the opioid crisis is so massive, and we compensate through the Affordable Care Act at that time, so much money for 1 year in tox screen was, they were getting like $2,500, okay? So there was a big kickback, and they were just going ahead and they were trafficking her and paying girls to relapse. Very, very sad. Go ahead, Hannah.
So who are the traffickers? 36% are your immediate family. Your mom, your dad, your sister, your brother. I have heard victims say that their first trafficker was their grandpa or her brother. And 27% are your boyfriends. We had she wasn't my victim, but she was one of my coworkers. She was dating this guy. They were like 3 years apart. She was still in high school, but he was like 18 or 19. And they were dating for 6 or 9 months. He had been over to their house, played with her siblings. They had dinners together. One day he told her, hey, it's time, like, I would really like for you to meet my family since we're getting more serious. She went to his apartment only to find out that he had men waiting for her to service. And I can't make this up, but in the process of her being trafficked, one of the Johns kidnapped her from her current pimp. And he had nowhere to take her because he had a wife and a kid at home. He took her to a hotel. And when she went to the bathroom, she realized there was a window in the back. And she jumped out the window and she was running down the street. And a bystander picked her up and brought her to Metro. She was only 16 years old. So her trafficker was her boyfriend. So there are three types of traffickers: individual, family, and organized crime. The individuals is your Romeo and your gorilla. So they're two opposites. Romeo is the one that Kristin talks about, where they use manipulation, they use emotions, they are in love, they're trustworthy, you know, we're used together, we, you know, I do this for you. And the gorilla is your opposite. That those are your guys that, you know, failure to turn tricks will result in consequences. They're the ones that are using Narcan as a punishment. The Romeo will never use it as a punishment. It will not even be on the books anywhere where he threatens her with Narcan. Then you have your family, which we'll talk about in just a second. It can be your parents, like I said, it could be your mom. And then the organized crime is when Kristin talks about, like, the gangs, the CEOs of the companies. How many times have we heard women or young girls get recruited from other countries where the guy goes and says, hey, I have a modeling agency, shows her a website. It's not that hard to build a website, right? I'm not a professional, but I can probably build a website in
a day or two. That's also your cartels, too.
Yeah.
And the cartels are very, we have a lot of problem because there's a lot of cartels coming in our country right now, too, and they're driving this.
The big things that we see in healthcare, we heard a lot. Big Mama. I actually had a patient talk about a Big Mama aunt when they come in with their trafficker, because the trafficker can be a woman too, right? Doesn't have to be a male. And then uncle or cousin, and sometimes they'll come in and they'll say my neighbor or my friend. What do they look like? Well, they can look like any one of these people, right? It can, like I said, could be a woman. They can be a tattooed guy up that looks like he belongs in prison. It can also be, so this was in Broadview, it was a recent thing, like a couple of weeks ago, they raided a massage parlor, and it was a sex trafficking ring. And this was in 2019, there were 13 massage parlors that were raided. It's here, we're just not seeing it, right? It's literally all local places.
So this was a case that was out of Elyria, and this was really concerning because it had to do with four females, one of which were 16, and they all had accrued a drug debt. Anna and I both have a theory that that young lady that's on the screen that ended up being a recruiter, we have a feeling she was probably trafficked at some point and had turned.
Priest, since 1999 in Toledo, was just recently indicted. He was exploiting young boys. His youngest victim was 5, 11, and 13. Those were his first three victims since 1999.
And he did what? He introduced opioids.
This young man, and the only reason this article, not the only reason, but one of the biggest reasons this article stood out to me is that he literally told the police that the reason and the women that he targeted was because they were fighting an addiction, and he exploited that for his financial gain. He told them that.
It's very, very common, very common. So this was a case here out of Lorain County, and that was Stephen Gilbert. And again, we know a lot of his stories because we know one of his victims. And he was a terrible man, but she testified against him and put him for, I think it was 184 years he got. So thank God, because he had a lot of women and he did a lot of horrible things. And it was things that would make your skin crawl. So this was one of the cases of using naloxone as a punishment. Naloxone is also known as Narcan. He actually was chasing a woman around with a syringe filled with it and threatening her and raped her. And it was also a case of human trafficking.
Yeah, the same man, while he was incarcerated, ran a prostitution ring on the outside by still threatening women.
While he was incarcerated. It's absolutely crazy. This is a really sad case when we were first pulling cases, because we want you to understand it's here in Ohio, and all of these are relatively local cases. This was three moms that all had substance use disorder. That gentleman was actually in their family, and he would say that he would babysit them, and they were trading sexual access to their young 7-year-old daughter, was the youngest one, through Facebook Messenger. All of this is going on, and the moms even did sexual X and videotaped it to their children to trade for substances. I just want you to understand that opioids hijack the brain. While I personally, as a mother of four sons, could not understand doing that, I want you to understand the power of opioids and what they do to the human brain so that a mother would actually do that to her child. And that brings us to pedophilia.
Pickle Park and Boulder are the terms commonly used for young boys that are being for sale. Anybody ever heard of Pedo Bear? Well, when I first learned about Pedo Bear, I had to Google it, but I thankfully used my work computer. But I couldn't remember the term Pedo Bear, so I typed in into Google on my work computer, "I'm a man who likes little boys. What tattoo should I get?"
We don't recommend that you do that.
Okay. Guess what popped up? Pedo Bear. Symbol for pedophilia.
There was actually a Dolce & Gabbana advertisement like a year to 2 years ago. They got a lot of real bad flack in the media because they had two little children posing with a Pedo Bear, and people picked up what it was.
So they also have symbols to define what their preference is. You have a triangle. It means they like boys, teenagers. The little round one, it means they like little boys, so prepubescent. Then the heart means they like little girls, or if it's like a butterfly with two little hearts, it means they have no preference, boy or girl, as long as they're prepubescent. They also have a online presence social media activism logo, and as you can tell, it has a triangle and the heart in it. They also wear jewelry and have pennies to indicate what their preference is. This one was a little bit harder to find, and I'm surprised the FBI was not knocking on my door with the things I was typing into Google, but I did find it under the FBI pedophile symbols. This is what came up for the pedophilia jewelry and symbols.
So what it would be is like if I was wearing a necklace and I was at a party, like Anna was a trafficker, and I wore what I was interested in, I would wear that necklace. She would see that, then come up and hand me that quarter that says, "I have a child for you to buy," and then I should follow her. So it's all done without being, you know, on technology. But I want you to understand, when we kind of circle back to opioids and human trafficking, is that the women in the carceral setting, the emergency room and the carceral setting, are probably one of the biggest hotbeds for patients to be identified, because these women are arrested for everything. Because as we're trying to get you to understand, human traffickers are the puppet masters that are making these women, by threats for fraud, force, and coercion, do everything. So these women, when I worked at the correctional center, I did not have any of this knowledge. I would literally be booking in a woman with substance use disorder who was coming in for maybe theft, prostitution sometimes, receiving stolen goods, drug trafficking, whatever it was. And I had no idea that she was a human trafficking survivor, or that was her situation. I literally would sit there and I would say, okay, I need to put an addiction medicine consult in because she was withdrawing horribly. She would tell me I would use 2 grams of fentanyl a day or something like that. She would then tell me, I was screening her for OBGYN things. She's like, "I got a little something going on down there. Okay, I'm gonna get you in with OBGYN. She would have a wound from the IV drug use with an abscess. Do you think I saw that as a red flag? No, I did not. She needed a dental consult. Why? Because the substance use disorder erodes your teeth, but also not being able to wash and clean yourself in between 7 to 11 Johns a day, your dental care is terrible. So I'd be putting in a dental consult. I also needed to put in a mental health consult because she was horribly depressed or possibly feeling suicidal. Did I see any of those red flags? No, I did not. But we literally teach this now to all the medical staff that are doing the onboarding, and they're identifying these people too. And so these women come in and they're getting booked in for a multitude of things. And that's why we work with the recovery courts in Cuyahoga County. As of August 23rd of last year, the recovery courts for substance use disorder were also made human trafficking courts. And so when those women are identified, like Anna was saying, then they can also get them the needs that they get, the resources that they need.
Go ahead. When I teach my nurses what to look for, I always tell them, look for tension in the room, minimal to no eye contact. Are they unsure of the date, time, month, or the year? Do they not have control over their own money or finances? So like, this is where registration comes in, right? Because I'm a nurse in the back in the ER, I don't see them get registered. but during their registration, who holds the papers? Who pulled it out? Typically, we like the ones, you know, some of us who are married, we all know that our husbands never carry their papers, right? It's always, honey, where's my papers? This is different. This is one of those things where she can't even present her own documents. He will present the documents and he will take them back. Like, she can't even touch them. That's what I mean about lack of control of their own documentation. Are they inappropriately dressed for the weather? It's winter and she's wearing a tiny little sweater or even a tank top and flip-flops or tennis shoes and no socks, right? When we talk about evidence of controlling or dominating relationship, is she afraid to answer you back? Is she kind of sort of looking at him first to see if it's okay to respond? Those are some of the big red flags. The big age gap is another big red flag. What I tell people, not to say that there's anything wrong between age gap, but that's a red flag for us to look at amongst other red flags. I know we're running out of time, so I'm trying to. When I tell them to look in the chart, look at multiple or reoccurring STIs. Like the other day we had a girl, it was STD, STD, STD check, abdominal pain, pelvic pain, abdominal pain, pelvic pain, you know, miscarriage or, you know, spontaneous abortion. It was like, that's all she was coming into the hospital for, and it was multiple hospital systems, right? Because they jump from hospital to hospital. And of course, we're gonna talk about tattoos. Those are the big things. But how do you differentiate between a regular tattoo, because some of them are crowns, some of them are names. How do you differentiate between a trafficking tattoo and a non-trafficking tattoo? Anybody wanna guess? Anybody here have tattoos? So have you ever met people with tattoos, right? And when you say, oh my God, what a cool tattoo, I really like your tattoo, what is their response? Oh, thanks. I got it 2 years ago because it was in the memory of my grandma who passed away, right? The biggest tattoo everybody always tells me is they love my tattoo of the hearts. And they're like, oh my God, that's so cool for a nurse. And I said, well, that's not just any heart. I'm like, this was my grandma, this was my mom, this is me. It has a meaning to me, and I love talking about it because it's positive. For these women, it has a very negative memories that are tied to it, and they're going to withdraw when you ask them about it. Even if you mention that tattoo, they will say, oh, it's nothing, it's no big deal, I don't really want to talk about it. Those are your big red flags. So what do these tattoos look like? They look like this. They look like flowers, names. They will look like a crown, barcodes, property off. When I tell you my very first victim, when I was getting her body ready for the coroner and I had to cut off all the clothes and stuff, she had a property of tattoo on her mom's pubis. And for those of you not in the medical field, it's usually where the C-section, you know, area is for women. It said property of tattoo and it had a name. And all of us thought, oh wow, what a stupid thing to do. That's what we said. Why would you put that on your body? That is so silly. You're only 18. Why would you do that? Well, because she didn't do that. Now I know that, because it was put on her, right? So pay attention to those things.
And like Anna said, a lot of them can be really benign, so it's conversational. If you think one of them, she tells a story of how she thought one of them was a trafficking tattoo. She started with the two that she didn't think and just started a conversation. Like she said, what a nice font, things like that. And you gauge the change in behavior from the one that may have a positive meaning to the one that was forced upon them. So why don't people ask for help? The biggest thing is stigma, whether it's stigma in our police force, whether our law and judicial system, but mainly the health care. A lot of foreign victims are being told that they will be deported. Our human trafficking in this country has in the last few years gone up like 140% because we really don't know who's coming across the border. And like I said, a lot of people are part of the cartel and a lot of these kids are getting lost. And so that is a very valid threat to make, that they think that they're going to get deported. So a lot of fear if they escape, and they may have a lot of threats against their family members and loved ones. So When we talk about, real quick, the cycle of addiction, so for me, I always think about my friend, and I know we've got like just about 5 more minutes because we got lost on time, or we were late on time. So when I think about my friend, her parents suffered with alcohol problems, and I can remember her at a very young age starting to self-medicate. And that wasn't that she had a full-blown substance use disorder. She was experimenting like a lot of teenagers did. That quickly turned into a full-blown substance use disorder. She started looking for more powerful substances, things like opioids. And because she then had a full-blown substance use disorder with opioids, it made her very vulnerable, and she met people, and she was taken away from Lake County into Cuyahoga County with the gangs. That led her to be horrifically victimized in ways that it's not my place to share. And then that led to trauma and mental health problems. Why is it a cycle? Because when you and your time is on the streets, your coping skill is opioids. How hard is that cycle to break? So that when things start getting hard and you don't have those opioids in your system and all of this trauma starts pouring in, what do you wanna do? You don't wanna think, you don't wanna feel, so you wanna go back to those opioids. Why do we return to the trafficker? Well, because cravings are powerful and opioids are very powerful substances. And while we have treatments for things like buprenorphine and Suboxone, they don't make you totally numb like fentanyl and opioids do. And so it's really important that we start talking about how to deal with the trauma of everything that you saw and everything that you did and the guilt and the shame that you feel, because opioids were your way to deal. So it is a very collaborative approach from mental health, substance use disorder, and the trauma. We have to meet their basic needs, but along every step of the way, if we don't address the substance use disorder, those women will relapse, and they go where? Back to their trafficker. So we can skip past this. There's a lot of barriers. A lot of them we've already talked about. So we want to make sure, no matter where you work, that you address stigma. If you have somebody calling someone a junkie or you hear those things, take a second and just put somebody on the right path. Because ultimately, we all want to help somebody. Hopefully we should, okay? In healthcare, that's what I say. We all got in this to save lives. The way that we save lives is just looks a little different here. We need to talk about these things in all of our communities and train on them and have a plan, no matter where you work. What do you do if you suspect human trafficking? We can tell you here in Lake County, so on the front of this guide, you'll see the Northeast Ohio Human Trafficking Task Force. That is a 216-443 number that gets routed to the Cuyahoga County Sheriff's Department. But they cover Lake, Geauga, Ashtabula, and Cuyahoga County. So if you were working and you saw something on the streets and you're like, man, that looks like human trafficking, you can call that number and give them a tip, okay? So we see victims everywhere. They are everywhere, but we primarily see them in the carceral setting and in the healthcare setting. Anna was gonna talk real quick about the screening tool.
So I found this on the National Human Trafficking Training and Technical Assistance Center. It's a screening tool that they recently developed that is trauma-informed. We currently have one at Metro, but it was built like 10 years ago, and we still do use it, but this one is a little bit more trauma-informed, and it was created with the help of survivors. So they basically told us the best way for us to talk to them, and we actually just went live with it last week. So I'm kind of super excited to be able to use that here at Metro. And this is our very last slide. It takes an army, like Kristin always says. And these are the services that we try to help all of our patients. Whether they need emergent food and clothing, this is where I come in. Do they need an urgent substance use treatment? That's where Kristin comes in. Do they need emergency shelter? I work with the trauma recovery team for them to help me find a safe place for them. Do they need, you know, transportation through the VOCA grant? We will help them get to their appointments. Do they need legal representation or help? This is where we get a hold of our new friends at the recovery court. So whatever the patient needs are, whatever the survival needs are, we try to meet them. But the one thing that I always remind my patients, and I call them my patients because they are my patients, but I always remind them that they are in control. I had one victim say that she didn't want to come in She had been sexually assaulted, but she says, I don't want to come in because you're going to make me do this. And I said, you don't control. If you want to come in just for treatment of the sexual assault and you want medication, I will do that. And if you want to go back out on the street, that's on you. I will supply you with whatever you want. You don't want to go to a shelter? I'm not going to make you go to a shelter. You are driving the train. Why? Because while they're under control of their pimp, they're being told what to eat, where to sleep, what to do, what to dress. I'm not going to be that person, but I will tell them that I'm here for them. And believe me, I have had two victims months later call me at my office and say, oh my God, I just ran away, but I don't know where to go. Come to me. I'm right here in the office. I will see you. I have kept patients in the hospital. I've kept them in the emergency room for 2-3 days while I was looking for a safe plan or a safe housing for them. But we did it. We found them a safe place, and we did it with them running the show while I still use the evidence-based practice on what I can do from a nursing perspective. But I also have to take them into account and put them ahead of what I want.
So real quick, no matter what area you work in, SOAR, I'm going to go back to that. Thank you. she gets a little trigger happy with the slides sometimes. SOAR, no matter what area you work in, this is a really great thing through the National Human Trafficking and Training Institute. So it has all different areas. This is all free education, so we're obviously not going to make you a trained professional on human trafficking. This is really good education that you can take for free. I brought Narcan today. If you have never used Narcan, there is inside this packet 2 doses. This is free, or you could go to Giant Eagle and buy it for $49.99 and you don't even get your fuel perks anymore. I know, and it's behind the counter, so you gotta ask for it. It's 2 doses, there's 4 milligrams in each. I always encourage anyone, if you have teenagers who babysit, pick up one of these, give it to them. If you have kids going off to college, because we're losing a lot of college kids to overdoses because they're trying stuff and it has opioids in it. Over the summer in Cuyahoga County, we lost multiple children under the age of 1 because it's made to look like candy now. And what do our babies do when they're little? They put everything that's colored in their mouth, right? So it doesn't matter who you are, you should carry Narcan because it's not always somebody who's struggling with substances who ends up overdosing, okay? What you do, you literally put it up there, up your nose. Can you advance that one more, please? Can you go back? We're just going to talk real quick. Inside here, there is a QR code. If you have never used Narcan, it has all of our resources at Metro, but it has training videos on it. It also tells how to use it inside here, okay? So if you have someone's unresponsive, even a kid, you can try to use it. Obviously, we're gonna call 911 first, right? Because we don't know if it's an overdose. If you find paraphernalia, you might have a sneaking suspicion that it is, but you never know. Oftentimes the breathing is really slow. People might look blue. If you have a darker, beautiful complexion, it's harder to tell if you're turning blue. If I'm overdosing, I'm gonna look blue, right? So pupils being really small and constricted is always a cardinal sign that it's an opioid overdose. It's one of the few things that makes your pupils tiny, like the tip of your pen, okay? Take this, you open it, up the nose, squeeze it. It literally is like giving yourself Flonase or Sudafed or something like that. It's gonna seem like an eternity. It takes about 3 minutes for this stuff to start working. You may need to support their breathing. So we give you a handy dandy face mask if you feel comfortable and you are trained, okay? There's always that. It may be anything to where these people are just really out of it. They have no heartbeat, so they may need CPR. Again, there's training videos in here. There are 2 doses in here. Don't keep this in your car in the 120 degree summers and the negative 20 degree winters. I tell ladies, keep it in your purse. If you're going on a road trip, throw it in your backpack, something like that, okay? If you use this, Lake County has a project on that they give these out, but you can also go to harmreductionohio.org and they mail it to your house for free. It's amazing. And also through the Ohio Department of Health. They're wonderful. So there's always Narcan to be had. If you forget, just Google it like Anna does and you can find out where to get it in Ohio. If you want to come over to my dark side and learn more about addiction, I love addictiontraining.org. It's all free continuing education on anything from alcohol to stimulants to treating people in pregnancy to treating in the carceral setting. And it's all for us like nurses and stuff. You get your free CEs. So it's really great. But there's a lot to be learned, and it takes an army, like Anna said, to advocate for these people. Anything? I think that's the last slide. I think last might be our contact info. I'm khess@metrohealth.org. I forgot my business cards today. She's abecks@metrohealth.org. It goes right to our phones, so you can email us if you have any questions, suggestions for improvement. I know we went over a bit today, but I could talk to you for 2 hours just on drugs, and let me tell you, it'd be fun. Okay?
Do you guys have any questions? I know it's a heavy topic, and it's a lot of information.
There's cards. Did make sure you got these. The one with the little like fire emblem on there is for anyone who works in healthcare. So you can take one even if you don't and give it to someone you love who works in healthcare. The other one just talks about trafficking versus smuggling. And then I know that we're sitting in Lake County, but this just is a really good guide that we came up with Metro that talks about what is substance use disorder, specifically what is opioid use disorder and what treatment options are out there. We have a lot of great treatment options in Lake County as well, but we always have room for more at MetroHealth if you know anyone who's struggling. That's it.
Thank you for having us.